القرآن يوحدنا لطريق الخير يوجهنا الله تعالى أنزله ورسول الله معلمنا.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ويوم نحشر من كل أمة فوجا ممن يكذب بآياتنا فهم يوزعون. On that day we shall gather from every nation a multitude of those who disbelieved our revelations. Then they shall be arranged in classifications according to their merits. Until when they have all arrived, their Lord will ask, "Did you deny my revelations without gaining their comprehensive knowledge? If not, then what else were you doing?" Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, on Yawmul Qiyamah, Allah is going to gather from every nation the disbelievers of that nation. And once Allah has done that, now they will be divided into rows according to their ranks. Some of them would have disbelieved 100%, others 75% or 50% or 10%. So they will be ranked according to their amount of disbelief. Then they shall be arranged in classifications according to their merits. Until when they have all arrived, then Allah will ask them, "Did you deny my revelations without gaining their comprehensive knowledge?" Allah will ask us on that day, without even understanding the meaning of the Quran, "You were denying my commandments?" There are many people today who do that. They have not even understood the Quran. They have not read the Quran in depth. And without understanding that message, they say, "No, this cannot be done today. This cannot be done today. This command is too difficult. This command was only for that period 1400 years ago." Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is asking, without even understanding, you're denying them? If not, what else were you doing? The sentence will be carried out against them for the consequence of their wrongdoings, and they will not be able to utter a word. Today people argue, they give all kinds of, involved in all kinds of discussions, why this commandment of the Quran and Hadith is not applicable, how this is barbarianism, how capital punishment should not be given, etc. So they go on arguing, but on Yawmul Qiyamah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to show to them, and when they see Allah, they will become tongue-tied. They will not be in a position in which they can argue in front of Allah, because all their false excuses would have evaporated that day. The sentence will be carried out against them for the consequence of their wrongdoings, and they will not be able to utter a single word. Allah has created all of us for His ibadat. So Allah will ask us, what else were you doing? I had created you to worship me, and worship means obedience. If we do not obey Allah's commandments, what else were we doing? Allah is going to ask us that day, were you worshipping your nafs, that you did everything which pleased you and you were not ready to obey Allah's commandments? Do they not see that we have made the night for them to rest in and the day to give them light? Surely there are signs in this for the true believers. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that out of the blessings of Allah is night. Allah made night so that people can rest and relax and become fresh again. And Allah made the day for them to earn their livelihood, to do various chores in life. If Allah did not make that, then was it in the power of man to do it? Allah is asking us, if it is not in your power, then why don't you bow down to the Creator who has made everything for your comfort? وَيَوْمَ يُنْفَخُ فِي السُّورِ فَفَزِعَ مَنْ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَنْ فِي الْأَرْضِ إِلَّا مَنْ شَاءَ اللَّهُ وَكُلٌّ أَتَوْهُ دَاخِرِينَ. On the day when the trumpet shall be blown, and all who dwell in the heavens and the earth shall be terrified and they'll swoon, except those whom Allah will choose to spare. And all shall come to Him in utter humiliation. When the trumpet is blown, all in the heavens and the earth, they will all swoon and be terrified, except Allah's special people, whom Allah will choose to spare. and all shall come to him in utter humiliation. These mountains which you see and think that they are firmly fixed, they will pass away like clouds. Such is the might of Allah, who has perfected all things. When we see tunnels being made in mountains, we see dynamite being used. And when dynamite is used, we see the mountains blowing away like dust. Or when we see these earthquakes and these buildings crumbling down, what do we see? Huge buildings, huge apartment complexes crumbling down, and what is left then? A cloud of dust. Astaghfirullah. This is what is going to happen on Yawmul Qiyamah. All these mountains and buildings and everything on the face of the earth will just turn into a cloud of dust, and that cloud will then settle down. So Allah says, these mountains which you see and you think that they are firmly fixed, they will pass away like clouds. Such is the might of Allah, who has perfected all things. He is aware of what you do. Those who have done good deeds shall be rewarded with what is better, and they shall be secure from the terror of that day. Man jaa bil hasanati falahu khairum minha. Whoever has done something good, then they are going to get a much better reward than what they have done. And they shall be secure from the terror of that day. And those who have done evil deeds shall be flung upon their faces in the hellfire. Should you not be rewarded according to your deeds? O Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, say to them, I have been commanded to worship the Lord of this city, meaning Makkah, the one who has made it sacred and who is the owner of all things. And I am commanded to be of those who are Muslims. And the word Muslim means one who submits to Allah's commandments. And that I should recite the Quran. Now whoever follows this guidance will be guided for his own good. And to him who goes astray, say, I'm merely one of the warners. Then proclaim, praise be to Allah. Very soon he will show you his signs, and you will recognize them. Your Lord is not unaware of what you do. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that amongst the commandments given to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, one of the commandments was that I should recite the Quran. Meaning Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was given this commandment. And why was he commanded this? The initial audience of the Quran were the Arabs. They could have read it themselves. They didn't need any dictionaries to understand the translation. All it means is that the Quran is a dialogue. It is the dialogue of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It was not revealed in the form of a written text, a written book, a written scripture. Rather, it was revealed as the dialogue, the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which were carried by Jibreel alayhi salam to the heart of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he was commanded to recite them. And thus we can understand the Quran much better when we hear it from a teacher. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was asked to explain the Quran to the people. This again shows us that it is not the same if we sit at home with the Quran and we read its translation, or we keep a dictionary next to us. It is not the same thing as trying to understand the Quran with the teacher, because that is the sunnah of understanding the Quran. Suratul Qasas. This is also a Makkan surah. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Tawseem Meem. Tilka ayatul kitab al-mubin. Natlu alayka min naba'i Musa wa Fir'aun bil-haqqi li qawmi yu'minun. Tawseem Meem. These are the verses of the glorious book that makes the things clear. In all truth, we narrate to you some information about Musa alayhi salam and the Pharaoh for the instruction of the believers. Meaning there are lessons to be learned in the story of Musa alayhi salam. Inna fir'auna ala fil ardi wa ja'ala ahlaha shia'in yastad'ifu ta'ifatan minhum yuzabbihu abna'ahum wa yastahyi nisa'ahum innahu kana minal mufsidin. It is a fact that the Pharaoh elevated himself in the land, and he divided its residents into groups, one group of which he oppressed, put their sons to death, and spared only their females. Indeed, he was one of the mischief makers. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us how the Pharaoh ruled. His policy was divide and rule. He divided the people into groups. One group he weakened, and this group was the group of the Israelites. He would put their sons to death and leave their females to serve as slaves for the Egyptians, for the Coptic Egyptians. Indeed, he was one of the mischief makers. But we wanted to favor those who were oppressed in the land. Allah wanted to favor the Israelites, to make them leaders, to make them the heirs, to establish them in the land, and to show Pharaoh, Haman, and their warriors at their hands the same which they feared. Why had the Pharaoh ordered the sons of the Bani Israel to be slaughtered, to be killed? Because somebody had told him that a child will be born who is going to bring your kingdom to an end. And so in order to prevent that from happening, the Pharaoh had commanded that every male child being born to the Israelites should be put to death. However, look at Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the way he works. That same child who was going to make this happen, meaning Musa alayhi salam, he was made to be raised in the palace of the Pharaoh himself. This is how Allah works. So we revealed our will to the mother of Musa, meaning Allah's plan was revealed to the mother of Musa. Suckle him, and when you feel any danger to his life, cast him into the river without any fear or grief, for we shall certainly restore him to you and make him one of our messengers. Musa alayhi salam's mother was told that as soon as she starts fearing that somebody from the king's army might come to kill her son, she should throw him in the river. And Allah's promise was that he is going to restore her child to her. We made the Pharaoh's family pick him up from the river. It was intended that Musa alayhi salam may become their adversary and a cause of their sorrow. Surely the Pharaoh, Haman, and their warriors were all sinners. So when Musa alayhi salam's mother was made to throw Musa alayhi salam in a basket in the river, the basket floated towards the palace of the Pharaoh. And who picked up the basket? The Pharaoh's wife, Queen Asiya. She picked up the basket, and because the Pharaoh and his wife were childless, so she requested her husband to allow her to adopt this as a child. And Allah had put such love on Musa alayhi salam. He was so cute, and he was that whoever saw him fell in love with this baby. And so when the Pharaoh saw this baby, he also couldn't resist it. So he allowed his wife to keep this child. And that is how Musa alayhi salam was made to grow up in the house of the Pharaoh. The wife of, and who was Haman? Allah says, surely Pharaoh, Haman, and their warriors were all sinners. Haman was the chief minister of the Pharaoh, who was the chief advisor of the Pharaoh, in charge of all the administration, the making the buildings, etc. The wife of the Pharaoh said, this child may become the comfort of the eyes for me and for you. Do not kill him. He may prove useful to us, or it may be that we will adopt him as our son. They were unaware of the result of what they were doing. On the other hand, the heart of Musa's mother was sorely troubled. She was the mother after she had released her baby in the water in a basket. Now she became extremely worried for her child. She would have disclosed as to who he was had we not strengthened her heart so that she might become one of the true believers. She said to Musa alayhi salam, sister, go and follow him. So she told Musa alayhi salam's sister to go and follow that basket and see where it goes. So Musa alayhi salam's sister watched him from a distance in such a way that the others did not notice it. We had already ordained that he would refuse to suck any foster mother. His sister came to the Pharaoh's wife and said, shall I point out to you a house whose people will take care of him for you and they'll be sincere to him? Thus did we restore him to his mother, that her eye might be comforted, that she might not grieve, and that she might know that the promise of Allah is true, yet most of the people do not understand. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is showing to us that Allah had promised Musa alayhi salam's mother, he will comfort her heart and return the baby back to her. And so this is how Musa alayhi salam refused to suckle from any foster mother, and the sister guided the people towards her own mother. And so the own mother started suckling this baby. She was hired, she was paid, a handsome salary for suckling this little prince that was being raised in the castle. Little did the people know that he was being suckled by his own mother. So this is how Allah works, and Allah says, yet most of the people do not understand. And so when people are made to pass through challenges in life, they cannot do sabr, they are not patient. Why? Because they do not know of Allah's plan. Had Musa alayhi salam not been raised in the palace of the Pharaoh, then the whatever Allah wanted to take from him, that mission, it would not have been accomplished until and unless Musa alayhi salam understood the culture, the mindset of these people. And so he was made to be brought up in the castle of the Pharaoh himself. وَلَمَّا بَلَغَ شُدَّهُ وَاسْتَوَى آتَيْنَاهُ حُكْمًا وَعِلْمًا وَكَذَلِكَ نَجْزِي الْمُحْسِنِينَ. When he reached maturity and became fully full grown, we bestowed on him wisdom and knowledge. Thus do we reward the righteous. Musa alayhi salam was a muhsin. Muhsin means one who does good to everybody, one who is proactive in doing good. He doesn't wait for an opportunity of doing good to come towards him. Rather, he actively looks out for ways by which he can earn righteous deeds, amle saleh. When somebody is bad to him, he does good to that person. When somebody is cruel to him, he is kind to that person. When somebody says hurtful words to a person, this person speaks kind words to him. This is the meaning of the word muhsin. Musa alayhi salam was a muhsin. So how did Allah reward him? Allah rewarded him with knowledge and wisdom. What is the meaning of the word wisdom? The ability to make the right decision, to know when to say, what to say, how much to say, when to act, what to act, how much to act. So this is wisdom. The application of knowledge, the application of knowledge in a way which is beneficial in the long term for the person himself and for all others around him. So Musa alayhi salam was granted wisdom and knowledge by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One day he entered the city at a time when its people were not yet active, meaning early morning. He found two men reaching each other's throats. They were fighting. One was from his own race, meaning he was an Israelite, and the other of his foes. He was a Coptic Egyptian. The man of his own race appealed for his help against his foe, whereupon Musa alayhi salam gave his foe a blow which killed him. Musa alayhi salam did not mean to kill that person. He just meant to keep that person away from harming this Israelite. So he just gave him a little blow, and he didn't know that this one blow was enough to kill him. On seeing what he had done, he said, this is from the work of Satan. Surely he is an enemy that openly misleads. Then he prayed, O my Lord, I have indeed wronged my soul. Please forgive me. Innahu huwa he said, Qala Rabbi inni zalamtu nafsi faghfir li faghfara lahu innahu huwa al-ghafurur rahim. So Allah forgave him. Surely he is the forgiving, the merciful. This is the attitude of the prophets of Allah. As soon as they make a mistake, what do? They immediately realize their mistake and they beg Allah's forgiveness. They repent and they reform. And when we look at our own attitude, when we make a mistake, even if somebody points out our mistake, we become very stubborn. We say, no, I didn't make any mistake. Rather, we throw the blame on other people and we are not ready to accept that we made a mistake. We become stubborn. We start giving justifications for our wrong. But what do prophets of Allah do? This is the prophetic way which we all need to learn. When we make a mistake, accept it, admit it, ask for Allah's forgiveness. So Allah forgave him. This is all that Allah wants from us, to realize our mistake, ask forgiveness from Allah, and move on in life, repent and reform. So Allah forgave him. Surely he is the forgiving, the merciful. Musa alayhi salam said, Oh my Lord, after this favor that you have bestowed on me, I shall never be a helping hand to the criminals. Next morning, as he was walking in the city in fear and caution, because he knew he had now, a man had died because of him. Suddenly he saw the same man whom he had helped the day before, cried out to him again for help. Musa alayhi salam told him, you are certainly a misguided person. You pick a fight with everybody, so you are a misguided soul. Then when Musa alayhi salam was about to lay his hands on a man who was an enemy to both of them, that man cried out, O Musa, do you intend to kill me as you killed a person yesterday? Meaning he was a witness to that incident, and he reminded Musa alayhi salam, you only want to become a tyrant in the land and you have no intention of reforming anything. At that time, there came a man running from the other end of the city. He was a well-wisher. He said, "O Musa, the chiefs are plotting to kill you. Therefore, run away. Surely I am your well-wisher." Hearing this, Musa alayhi salam left that place in fear and caution, praying. فَخَرَجَ مِنْهَا خَائِفًا يَتَرَقَّبُ قَالَ رَبِّ نَجِّنِي مِنَ الْقَوْمِ الظَّالِمِينَ. He prayed, "O my Lord, deliver me from the nation of wrongdoers." So notice Musa alayhi salam's connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He makes a dua to Allah. He speaks to Allah at every instant. Here again, he is running away. He did not go home to pack a suitcase. He just left immediately and he doesn't know where to go. And yet, what is he making a dua to Allah for? Rabbi najjini min al-qawmi al-zalimeen. O my Lord, deliver me, save me from the nation of wrongdoers. وَلَمَّا تَوَجَّهَ تِلْقَاءَ مَدْيَنَا قَالَ عَسَى رَبِّي أَنْ يَهْدِيَنِي سَوَاءَ السَّبِيلِ. As he made his way towards Madian, he said, "Soon my Lord shall guide me to the right way." When we are undecided about something, this is the way to make dua to Allah. Asa Rabbi an yahdiyani sawa as sabil. It may be that my Lord will guide me to the right way. When we do istikhara from Allah, it doesn't mean that we are definitely going to see something which will lead us. No, istikhara means asking for Allah's help to do what is the good thing, what is the right thing to do. Musa alayhi salam is also making a dua to Allah. Asa rabbi an yahdiyani sawa sabil. Maybe that Allah will show me the right way, shall guide me to the right way. When he arrived at the well of Madian, he saw a multitude of men watering their flocks. And besides them, two women were keeping their flocks back. Imagine a bunch of thirsty animals. But these two ladies, because of their modesty, they did not want to mingle with the men folk. The shepherds, male shepherds, were watering their flocks. So these two women, they kept their flocks back. Even though their flocks must have been thirsty, must have been wanting to go and have water, but they kept them back. And this shows the importance of modesty in women. They did not want to go and mingle with men freely. He asked, "What is the problem?" They replied, "We cannot water our flocks until the shepherds take away their flocks from the water. And our father is a very old man." So he Musa alayhi salam, imagine how tired he must have been. His shoes must have been worn out. He was hungry, he was thirsty, he was in a state of fear. He had no home, no money in his pocket, no food, nothing. He was just sitting under a tree watching this scene, and he sees that these two women had their own flocks, but they were not watering them. So he goes to them and says, "What's the problem? Why are you not taking these thirsty animals to the water?" So the two ladies told them that we do not mingle with these male shepherds, and we have to come to water our flocks because there's no male member in the family, and our father is a very, very old man, so he's weak. So this shows us that if there's no male earning member, it's okay for women to go and work. This part of the Quran proves this point. However, these ladies, they had their modesty intact. They did not mingle with men. So it means that even if a woman is forced by circumstances to go out to work because there's no male member to earn for her, yet she has to remain within the limits of the Sharia. So he watered their flocks for them and went back to the shade and prayed. So this shows us the attitude of Musa alayhi salam. He was a Mohsin. He couldn't wait to see why these poor women were not watering their flocks. He went and he did it on their behalf. The women did not come to him seeking his help. On the contrary, he himself went to help these women out. And after watering them, he did not want any money or any wages from them. He just came back. He had done his good deed. He came back and sat again in the shade of the tree. And he made the dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He prayed, Rabbi inni lima anzalta ilayya min khayrin faqir. O my Lord, surely I'm in desperate need of whatever good that you may send down to me. It shows us the prophetic sunnah that when we are in desperate need, who do we turn to? Not to people. What can people give us? People are fuqara themselves, weaklings like us. A person needs to turn to Allah, do good deeds, but make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Soon after that, and look at the barakah of that dua, because Musa alayhi salam had no food, no money, no home, no salary, no job, no relatives, nothing whatsoever. He had nothing. He was totally a traveler with nothing at all. So he made this dua, and look at the barakah of this dua. Within a very short time, what happened? Soon after that, one of the two women came to him walking bashfully and said, "My father is calling you. He wishes to reward you for watering our flocks for us." Meaning the father was also a very righteous person. And when the girls told him, narrated to him that this stranger watered the flocks for us, so he said, "We have to pay him something for his generosity." When Musa alayhi salam came to him and narrated his story, the old man said, "Have no fear, you have escaped from those wicked people." So he must have narrated the entire incident. So the old man understood that this is a person who is very righteous. He said, "You have escaped wicked people." One of them said, "Father, hire him. The best that one can hire is a man who is strong and trustworthy." So this shows us that even a woman can give very wise advice. Even a young person can give wise advice to an elderly person. Here the daughters are giving advice to their father. "Father, hire this person, because number one, he has the capacity to water our flocks and do this work for us. And number two, he's very trustworthy." The old man said to Musa alayhi salam, "I am willing to give you one of my daughters in marriage if you stay in my service for 8 years, but you may complete 10 if you wish. I do not want to put you in trouble. Allah willing, you will find me one of the righteous." Musa alayhi salam replied, "So be it an agreement between me and you. Whichever of the two terms I complete, let there be no compulsion on me. Allah is the surety over what we have agreed upon." Imagine, the old man understood that he has a house in which there are only girls. He cannot keep a young man just like that in the house. So he said, and he knew he came from a very good family, he was a very righteous person. So he said, "You can stay in my house. I will marry you to one of my daughters. And on the condition that you stay with us for 8 years and serve us. And if you wish to stay for 10 years, then that is your own choice." Now, this shows us that at the time of marriage, a father-in-law, the girl's father, can keep conditions. This also shows us that the girl's father can give a proposal to the boy's family. This is clearly proved out here. There's nothing, nothing shameful about that. And also Musa alayhi salam replied, "Be it." He accepted it. Ijab and Qubul, this is all that it takes for a nikah. And because there was nobody else present at that time, he said, "Allah is the surety of what we have agreed upon." So let's take a short break, and after that we'll see what happens after this.
Allah Ta'ala anzalahu wa rasuluhu.